During the next half an hour, we are going to be discussing Dr. Faustus, a tragedy written by Christopher Marlowe. Before we proceed to the details of the play, let us learn about the dramatist. Marlowe was one of the foremost Elizabethan tragedians, next only to Shakespeare. He was a famous playwright, poet, and translator as well. Marlowe's tragedies are known for protagonists who do not accept limitations or obstacles. In other words, they are overreachers. Dr. Faustus and Tamburlaine are typical examples of this kind of heroes. Marlowe was also the first English dramatist who made use of blank verse in his plays. Christopher Marlowe was born in Canterbury to a shoemaker named John Marlowe and his wife Catherine in the year 1564. Remember that 1564 is also the year of his contemporary Shakespeare's birth. Marlowe was educated at Corpus Christi College, Cambridge. He belonged to the group of playwrights called the University Wits. Apart from Marlowe, the prominent members of this group included Thomas Lodge, Thomas Nash, George Peele, and John Lyly. It was the University Wits who set the stage for the theatrical renaissance in Elizabethan England and paved the way for William Shakespeare in many ways. Christopher Marlowe's first production was a short play entitled Dido, Queen of Carthage, written along with Thomas Nash. His other plays include Tamburlaine the Great in two parts based on the life of the Turkic warrior Timur or Tamerlane, who rose from a shepherd to the ruler of an empire. The Jew of Malta, which is an original plot line of Machiavellian intrigues surrounding the revenge of Barabbas, a Jew, against the city authorities. Edward II, which deals with the English king's reign, fall, and death, and his homoerotic fascination for his favorite Piers Gaveston. The Massacre at Paris, which deals with the Saint Bartholomew Day's massacre of French Protestants called Huguenots by Catholics in 1572, and of course, Dr. Faustus. Marlowe's plays were immensely successful on the stage. He also wrote a mythological poem called Hero and Leander. Many legends grew around Marlowe during and after his lifetime. One of these was that Marlowe was a government spy. Marlowe was, of course, a reputed atheist, which was quite dangerous at a time when political conflicts had a religious basis. The reign of Elizabeth I was a time of many political conspiracies. In the 16th century, many poets and playwrights lost their life. The writers enjoyed no security of life. Marlowe was arrested, apparently on a charge of blasphemy. We do not know whether he was actually tried. In 1593, he was stabbed to death by a businessman named Ingram Fraser. Marlowe influenced Shakespeare substantially. Shakespeare's play Richard II is thematically similar to Marlowe's Edward II. Similarly, Marlowe's The Jew of Malta is said to have influenced Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice. Shakespeare also followed Marlowe in his use of the blank verse. Let us now discuss Marlowe's tragedy, Dr. Faustus. The full title of the play is The Tragical History of the Life and Death of Dr. Faustus. The play is based on the old German legend of Faust, in which a scholar sells his soul to the devil for unlimited knowledge and power. Many versions of the legend were available during Marlowe's time. Indeed, he made several changes in his version. For example, the introduction of the seven deadly sins. Marlowe also emphasized the hero's intellectual aspirations and curiosity in order to make him a typical Renaissance figure. Dr. Faustus was first performed probably in 1594. It created a powerful impact at the theatre. It is performed 25 times during the 3 years between 1594 and 1597 by the troupe called the Admiral's Men. But it was published only in 1604, 11 years after Marlowe's death. The dramatis personae of Dr. Faustus consists of the Pope, the Cardinal of Lorraine, the Emperor of Germany, Duke of Vanholt, Faustus himself, Waldus and Cornelius, friends to Faustus, Wagner, servant to Faustus, a clown, Robin, Ralph, Wintner, the horse courser, a knight, an old man, scholars, friars, and attendants, and of course, the Duchess of Vanholt. The second set of characters is supernatural. This includes Lucifer, the Prince of Devils, Beelzebub, Mephistopheles, the Good Angel, the Evil Angel, the Seven Deadly Sins, devils, and spirits in the shapes of Alexander the Great, his paramour, and of Helen of Troy. In the prologue, the chorus tells the audience what the play Dr. Faustus is about. As opposed to the medieval tradition, this play is not about wars or courtly love. It is about Faustus, a scholar who was born of low-class parents. The prologue talks about Faustus's intellectual abilities and superior achievements. He has been awarded a doctorate. Soon we get to know the cause of Faustus's downfall also. Quite appropriately, he is compared to Icarus, the mythological character who flew too close to the sun and fell to his death when the sun melted his waxen wings. The cause of the downfall in both the cases is what the ancient Greeks called hubris, excessive pride, or overstepping of bounds. Faustus says that he has reached the boundary of every subject, logic, medicine, law, and theology. Now he is bent upon going beyond the limits of knowledge and learning necromancy, or black magic, which literally involves communication with the dead. He calls upon his servant Wagner to bring Waldus and Cornelius, two famous magicians. As in a morality play, the good angel and the bad angel offer their perspectives on diabolical forces. Faustus is momentarily persuaded by the good angel, but he is overcome by the lures of magic. Waldus tells him that if a person of Faustus's capabilities and standing devotes himself to magic, many things are possible, many great things are possible, provided he vows not to study anything else. Faustus starts communicating with devils. A devil named Mephistopheles appears before Faustus. But Faustus is unable to tolerate Mephistopheles' hideous appearance. He wants Mephistopheles to change his looks. Mephistopheles obeys the command. Seeing this, Faustus feels pride in his newly gained skills. He tries to bind the devil to his service, but is unable to do so because Mephistopheles serves Lucifer, the Prince of Devils. Mephistopheles' statements are quite interesting here. They serve as spiritual warnings. He reveals that it was not Faustus' command which summoned him. If anyone abjures the scriptures, Satan comes to claim their souls. He narrates the history of Lucifer and the other devils. He tells Faustus that hell has no circumference. It is not a physical location. It is more a mental state or a moral condition. With Mephistopheles' help, Faustus enters into a pact with Lucifer. Faustus will have 24 years of life on the earth, during which time he will have Mephistopheles as his personal servant. In return, he agrees to give his soul to Lucifer and suffer eternal damnation in hell. Faustus has to seal this deal in his own blood. But when he does this, the wound is miraculously healed, and the Latin words meaning fly man appear on the wound. Despite this divine intervention, Faustus proceeds on the path of damnation. He asks Mephistopheles a series of questions concerning science, but the devil gives evasive replies, showing that he is untrustworthy. The good and bad angels reappear. The good angel urges Faustus to to repent and revoke his oath to Lucifer. But Faustus is blind to his own salvation. Let us remember that he was warned by Mephistopheles himself earlier. Lucifer presents before him a personification of the seven deadly sins: pride, covetousness, wrath, envy, gluttony, sloth, and lechery. Here, and in the appearance of the good and bad angels, we find elements of a medieval morality play. A morality play is a form of allegorical drama in which the protagonist, representing every man, is persuaded by personified virtues to choose a divine way of life and shun evil. These also feature personified vices, but Faustus fails to see them as warnings. From this point until the end of the play, Faustus does nothing worthwhile. Of course, he does many things as part of the omnipotent life he has been granted. He appeals to scholars and speaks about his damnation. He believes that God is merciful and seems to repent for a while. But Mephistopheles comes to collect his soul. We are told that he follows the devil to hell. Let us now discuss the major themes in the play Dr. Faustus. The first of these is theological issues. As you probably know, the English Reformation was initiated by Henry VIII on merely personal grounds. The Roman Catholic Church had denied him permission to divorce his wife and remarry. But theological issues remained a constant source of heated debate in Marlowe's England. No wonder, sin, salvation, and redemption are major themes in Dr. Faustus. In Christian theology, a sin is an act contrary to the will of God. Faustus strikes a deal with the devil. He exchanges his soul for earthly power and knowledge. This is the ultimate Christian sin. The presence of the good and bad angels and the appearance of the seven deadly sins make the Christian theme obvious. The solution to a committed sin is repentance and faith in Jesus Christ, the Savior. According to Christian theology, Jesus Christ sacrificed his life on the cross for human sins, and the sinner's soul is redeemed if he or she believes in Christ. He can save the sinner's soul by the gift of grace. Faustus is not entirely devoted to evil. He is internally divided between good and evil. But throughout a major part of the play, he continues to turn away from God and appears blind to his fate. He does not recognize that eternal damnation is worse than death. It is only towards the end that Faustus calls out the name of the Savior, Jesus Christ, but it is too late to repent. In other words, he renders himself incapable of redemption. The second theme is a conflict between Renaissance and medieval values. Scholar R.M. Dawkins has famously remarked that Dr. Faustus is a story of a Renaissance man who pays the medieval price for being one. Dawkins is drawing our attention to one of the major themes of the play, the conflict between the medieval world and the emerging world of the Renaissance. The medieval world placed God at the center of the universe. Human concerns were subordinated to divine schemes. During the Renaissance, the theocentric conception of the world gave way to an anthropocentric philosophy called humanism. Now, man became the measure of all things. The Renaissance emphasized the human capacity for achievement and man's quest for knowledge. Renaissance art and literature were characterized by freedom of thought, limitless ambition, love of splendor, aesthetic sensitivity, respect for the healthy human body, a keen appreciation of beauty, meticulous scholarship, and a new and broader acquaintance with the world. An ambience of exuberance and intelligence permeated every endeavor. Dr. Faustus embodies all these qualities of the Renaissance. In the medieval academy, theology was considered the queen of the sciences. But during the Renaissance, secular matters took the center stage. Scholars began to study classics. They also began to devote a lot of time to a scientific inquiry into the nature of the world. It is true that Faustus is a magician and not a modern-day scientist. But remember that during the 16th century, the distinction between the two was blurred. Faustus rejects the medieval model of knowledge based on tradition and authority. In his opening speech in Scene 1, he scans every field of scholarship and quotes an ancient authority for each. Aristotle on logic, Galen on medicine, Justinian on law, and the Bible on religion. In the place of tradition and authority, he prefers individual inquiry. He risks everything in his quest for knowledge, power, and wealth. In full Renaissance spirit, he refuses to accept limitations, traditions, or authorities. This is what we can call the Faustian soul, the basis of human progress. The paradox of Faustus's situation is that he is placed in the medieval world where the price for human pride is eternal damnation. But Marlowe was a reputed atheist. And his protagonist, Faustus, is a hero of the modern world, a world freed of God, of religion, and of all limitations upon human aspiration. In other words, he is a harbinger of enlightenment in Europe. The final theme we are going to discuss is knowledge and wisdom. In the concluding scene of the play, the chorus comments on the tragedy of Faustus. Cut is a branch that might have grown full straight, and burned is Apollo's laurel bough that sometime grew within this learned man. Dr. Faustus is also the tragedy of a man who does not know what to do with the tremendous knowledge he has gained. It is a pity that Faustus descends from his grand ambitions to petty conjuring tricks. We can also say that he possesses knowledge, but not wisdom. He subordinates knowledge and skills to the greedy craving for power, wealth, and pleasure. From a Christian point of view, he has forgotten the proverb, "Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom." From a secular perspective, he lacks discretion or the capacity for ethical choice in the use of knowledge. His fault may also be considered as lying in not accepting the realistic limits of what man can actually do in the face of external constraints. Let us now discuss the structure and style of the play Dr. Faustus. The act and scene divisions vary in different versions of Dr. Faustus. The modern text has 5 acts. As in the ancient Greek tragedies, Marlowe's play also has a chorus. But the chorus in Dr. Faustus does not interact with the other characters in the play. It merely provides the introduction and conclusion to the action of the play. It also offers some commentary on the action. An important dramatic device used in the play is the soliloquy. Marlowe makes effective use of this device to convey the conflicts in the mind of the protagonist. There are thematic parallels between the soliloquies at the beginning and at the end. At the beginning, Faustus wonders about his fate. At the end, he comes to terms with, or tries to come to terms with, the fate he has created for himself. Many critics think that the latter is a grim parody of the former. The play Dr. Faustus uses both prose and blank verse. We can see a pattern here. Blank verse is largely reserved for the main scenes, while prose is used in the comic scenes. These comic scenes are meant for comic relief. Some scholars believe that the comic scenes in Marlowe were interpolations. Let us conclude with some observations on Marlowe's use of the blank verse. As we noted earlier, Marlowe was the first English dramatist who made effective use of blank verse lines. What is blank verse? Blank verse is unrhymed lines in iambic pentameter. This is a meter in which most of the poetry in English has been written. In order to illustrate the use of blank verse and its grandeur, let me read out. Marlowe's blank verse lines have a grandeur and lyrical quality. Let me read out Foster's speech addressed to the apparition of Helen of Troy. Was this a face that launched 1,000 ships and burned the topless towers of Ilium? Sweet Helen, make me immortal with a kiss. Her lips suck forth my soul. See where it flies. Come, Helen, come. Give me my soul again. Here will I dwell, for heaven is in these lips. And all is dross that is not Helena. I will be Paris, and for love of thee, instead of Troy, shall Wurttemberg be sacked, and I will combat with weak Menelaus, and wear thy colours on my plumed crest. Yea, I will wound Achilles in the heel, and then return to Helen for a kiss.